Sushruta Phonete is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Hi students, so this class is for the class 11 to 12 students. class 11 to class 12 students, you know, who have finished class 11 and who need little bit of extra coverage with class 11 and then heading to class 12, you know. Now, some people, they cover what we are going to cover today in class 12, you know. They spend more time with class 11 to cover the mechanics, to cover simple harmonic motion, little bit of waves, they do it in class 11. Then in class 12, they go with, you know, they start with heat and then they go to additional materials around electricity and magnetism, and then finally modern physics. Okay, now we have just completed all the electricity and magnetism. I wanted to start with electricity and magnetism towards the beginning of the year, and therefore the last few months I have spent doing electricity and magnetism for the previous year's class 12. So you have all those lectures if you do want them. Okay, they are available in the Jnanamarga Tech YouTube channel. You know, full material is there if you're getting quickly ready. You know, and for the 12th. Class 12 exams, or of course for NEET JEE, and you're getting ready for the advanced exam, which has been of course postponed, as many of you have know, JEE advanced, or you're planning for the NEET exam. You know, this is a good time to get a crash course. Go to our lectures. I have recorded everything for the students for physics. Of course, download the app. You know, that is very critical. We have a summer program, you can use that, you know. So let me get going with our slides presentation again, so that you can learn what material we have. Okay, so today I'm going to start with thermal properties of matter, and as many of you know, this is this is a continuation of what we did last time, which is the mechanical properties of matter. So, thermal properties of matter tend to be, before I go there, let me explain the Jnanamarga platform. The Jnanamarga platform is based out of ebooks. Okay, it is on its basis, it has ebooks. So it helps a student study for the ebooks by providing related material. One is slides, the other is IIT PAL videos in context. So while you're reading material, you find slides, you find videos, you can talk to you can find Wikipedia, you can find other resources in the context of the textbook. Okay, so that makes the study of the textbook, that makes the study of questions, etc., much easier. Okay, so now what does the student do? A typical student, he downloads the, say if he's a NEET student, he downloads com, goes to Play Store and looks for com.jnanamarga.sushruta. He downloads the app. Okay, once you download the app, then the next thing you do is you start learning from the app. You do a registration. You send a mail to, if you have any issues, you send a mail to support@jnanamarga.in. Support Jnanamarga, JNANAMARGA. So support@jnanamarga.in, they will help you register and then you go from there. Okay. So com.jnanamarga.sushruta, download the app, get going if you are a NEET student. Okay. And if you are a JEE student, it's different. You have a different app. Okay. Now, if you wanted the high-end platform, integrated learning platform, high-end platform, we send you a tablet. And the tablet comes with HC Verma as an ebook. Okay. Then the other thing you get is you get also the A to Z books. Okay. Then you get, of course, the NCRT books come with the regular downloadable app. These apps are, by the way, very inexpensive. For the summer program, which you are now part of, this lecture is part of the summer program. These, the pricing on this is extremely low. It is $29.95 for the entire summer, and the summer goes on till Independence Day. Okay, so which is when we expect schools to reopen for post-class, post the lockdown, current lockdown underway due to COVID. Stay safe, you know. Now, if you are a purchaser of the tablet solution, which is 25,000 rupees, you will get a full tablet with, you know, so many books. And on top of that, we also send you the NEET questions, 30 years of NEET questions, you know, the A to Z books and the full slides for all the subjects. And you will get chat and you will get some custom help as well. Okay. Then, of course, you will get mock tests as well. You know, so this is the basis for our platform. Okay. The second part of, the second app that we have is the Ramanujan app for JEE students. The Ramanujan app is our product to help students who want to get through JEE. Again, it is $29.95 for the summer, you know, ₹2,995 rupees for up until Independence Day. So you have June, July, August to study with it, and you have quite a bit of time, and you can keep, you know, otherwise we buy the full year program, as with Sushruta or Ramanujan, buy the full year program, it will go all the way till, 2022 when the exams complete. That is $89.95. Again, not so much, you know. we want students to get full value for our program, succeed, because, see, your parents, they also have to pay for ongoing college, you know. And these are not very good times. So, you know, our program is aimed at being extremely helpful and extremely affordable, you know. So the Ramanujan platform also, we have a tablet version, 25,000 rupees. You get HC Verma Physics, but you also get the C-Engage. A to Z is also owned by C-Engage. C-Engage is our preferred book partner. And we have a relationship with them. You also get 39 years of question bank. And of course, you get everything that is in the Ramanujan app, which is downloadable from here, from the Play Store, right? And all the books that you get are integrated with the IIT PAL videos. Okay? And then what students can do is, in the case of Ramanujan, you can do the eAbhyas app, you can go to the Diksha app, and of course, today also freely available is the exams from Amazon Academy. So you have a lot of resources, and we will be releasing additional study material for the students as well as the year rolls on. You know, we'll be doing an important update to the app. You get going, you start studying. Right now, you must get the material strong. Okay. So having said that, let us go on to the matter at hand. Okay. Heat and temperature. So what happens to the various types of matter? Last time we looked at matter in terms of stress and strain and everything, right? Now we are going to look at matter in the context of heat. Okay, what does heat do? Okay, heat is also a form of energy. Okay, heat, you feel the temperature of something, right? So it becomes hot, right? What does that mean, right? Now, heat is a form of energy that is transferred between two systems or is in a system and its surrounding by virtue of its temperature difference. Okay, so now I have one something here, and then something here, and then if this something here is hot, I touch it, my hand removes, because my hand is only has a certain temperature. right? We all have, if you check your body temperature, it should be between 97 and 99, somewhere there, based on your age. I see people like me, a little bit older, a little bit, our body temperature is a little bit lesser. When I was in India, we always used to say 98.4 is a good body temperature, okay? And of course, temperature is a very important thing to look at. When people get coronavirus, the first thing they check is temperature, okay? Then they check the O2. Anyway, now the important thing here is the commonly used properties, to identify what is your temperature. How do they measure temperature? Right. And once they do that, then they again take it out and then they look at it, right? So when they look at it, they look at mercury. Okay. Mercury, why do they look at mercury? Okay, and they look at a little bit of mercury, right? Mercury is a liquid, okay? And it's a liquid and it's a metal. It's a liquid metal. So what happens to mercury is expands, okay. And they look at the level to which it has expanded. Okay, so the heat passes through, into the mercury, and then the mercury expands. It is because it expands precisely, right? So the mercury expands, and there is a very thin group, and then as it expands, it flows into that group. Okay. It is very difficult to, it is for that reason that they use a common liquid. So sometimes, they use alcohol in some other places. But mercury, the thermometer, is what I have used in my life so far. Okay, and so its volume varies linearly with temperature. Okay, so that's how heat is measured, right? So I say my body is hot. The temperature has gone up. I measure the use a thermometer, and then I take a look. So when I take a look, what do I see? Right, the temperature has gone up. Okay. Now there are three measures of temperature that you should learn. Okay, the first measure of temperature is centigrade. Right. Now, but when we say 98.4, we are talking about another type of temperature called Fahrenheit. Fahrenheit is actually a German word, okay? And it is used by the British. Degrees Fahrenheit. Now, Fahrenheit is typically when they say 98.4, they're talking Fahrenheit. Okay? Now, Fahrenheit is 32 degrees. Fahrenheit is 0 degrees centigrade. What is 0 degrees centigrade? Okay. Centigrade is another unit for temperature. 0 degrees centigrade is the temperature at which, under normal pressure, right, water freezes. Okay. Now there is a conversion of water into solid ice. It becomes ice. Right. Now, the thing with water is it has a certain anomalous properties. Normally, when the temperature of something keeps declining, it will become smaller and smaller and smaller, right? Look at mercury, right? Mercury, when you heat it up, it expands and becomes bigger, right? Now, water also will keep becoming bigger if you increase it from 20 degrees, 30 degrees onwards, right? So 30 degrees, 40 degrees, 50 degrees, it keeps becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay. It keeps expanding when you heat it up. Okay. But the thing with water is after it freezes, okay, and becomes ice, as you decrease the temperature, any other solid, when you decrease the temperature further, it will shrink, it will contract. Okay. Not water. What happens to water when you freeze it? It expands. That's why ice floats in water. I don't know if you have had a cool drink, gone and asked to go on to a restaurant somewhere and said, oh, it's such a hot day, can I have a Coca-Cola, sir? And the waiter, he brings you a glass of Coca-Cola and then with ice in it, and the ice floats on top, right? Why is that? That is because of the anomalous expansion of water. It becomes bigger with lower temperatures, okay? So that's why ice floats in the oceans, right? The North Pole is floats. North Pole is actually has the Arctic Ocean, right? Antarctica is land, but the North Pole is ice, okay? And that ice floats on water, okay? So now the 0 degrees centigrade is when water freezes under normal temperature and pressure, okay? 100 degrees centigrade is when you keep boiling water to 100 degrees, it becomes a gas, water vapor, right? So at 100 degrees, what happens is it absorbs a lot more energy and transforms into a different form of matter, a gas, okay? So there is this so-called latent heat, okay? Latent heat is the heat present in a particular form of matter, okay? Whether it is gas, whether it is liquid, etc. Okay. Now, what happens is normally when you heat something up, its temperature will go up. Okay. Now, except when it reaches these critical points where it will transform from one kind of one form of matter to another form of matter, that is from liquid to gas at 100 degrees centigrade, or from liquid to downwards into a solid at 0 degrees centigrade. Okay? Now, 0 degrees centigrade is 273 degrees Kelvin. This is the other scale, the third scale. The first scale is Fahrenheit, we discussed. Fahrenheit was used by the British, not used as much now. The second scale is centigrade. Each degree of Fahrenheit is 1.8 degrees of centigrade. Okay, or 1 degree of centigrade equals 1.8 degrees of Fahrenheit. 0 degrees centigrade is 32 degrees Fahrenheit. That is when water freezes. Okay, so typically the thing is you do 9 by 5. Okay, for each degree centigrade, you do 9 by 5 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, so and that's how you do it. Okay, so 32 degrees is when water freezes, or 0 degrees centigrade. Okay, now there is another scale called the Kelvin scale. The Kelvin scale was adopted after understanding this idea called absolute zero. Absolute zero means that beyond that there is no temperature. Okay, at absolute zero, things have frozen to a level at which there is no temperature. Okay, beyond that, it cannot become even cooler. And I'll tell you why. I'll explain to you why when I discuss kinetic theory, etc. Okay, so now what happens is, so what is this temperature? Temperature is, something that relates to heat. Okay? Heat is a form of energy. Temperature is how we measure heat. And temperature is measured by using how when you touch it, how much something that is touched with it expands. Okay, so temperature gets passed from your body to the thermometer. The thermometer as a result expands. Okay, that's how we detect the temperature of our bodies. Okay, and so we then discuss the three forms of measuring temperature: the Fahrenheit scale, the centigrade scale, and the Kelvin scale. 0 degrees centigrade. Centigrade and Kelvin are actually almost the same unit, only that 0 degrees centigrade is 273.5 degrees Kelvin. Okay, then centigrade, you have negative centigrade, but you don't have a negative scale for Kelvin. You don't have negative 5 Kelvin. You have 0 Kelvin and up. Okay, centigrade is, let's say if Kelvin was like this, centigrade will be like that. Okay, so what minus 273 degrees centigrade is called absolute zero, and absolute zero is 0 Kelvin. Okay, minus 273 centigrade is 0 Kelvin. So you just do TC plus 273 to get the Kelvin temperature. Okay, so and 100 degrees centigrade is when water becomes gas when heated, right? It converts, absorbs a lot of latent energy and then becomes another form of matter called gas, right? So now let's discuss what is this ideal gas equation. Okay, now there was Boyle and there was Charles. Okay, Boyle said that at a given pressure, okay, assume at a constant temperature, the pressure is inversely proportional to volume. Okay, so you increase the pressure of a gas, its volume will decrease. Okay, if you want to decrease the volume of a gas, you increase its pressure. Therefore, he said pressure is inversely proportional to volume, temperature kept constant. Then Charles came and he said when pressure is kept constant, volume is directly proportional to temperature. V by T is a constant. V equals KT, Charles' law. Okay, and then they combined the two together and they came up with what is called the ideal gas equation. PV equals NRT. Okay, N is in moles. Okay, P is measured in pressure. Pressure is measured in newtons per meter square. Volume is measured in meter cubed, and equals NRT. PV equals NRT. It is a combination of both Boyle's law and Charles' law. Boyle's law states PV equals constant. Right? What is that constant? It is NRT. What is N? N is the number of moles. Okay. R is what is called R is another constant. Okay. And the third one is T. T is the temperature in Kelvin. Remember, T is the temperature in Kelvin. Okay. So PV equals NRT. R is 8.31 joules per mole per Kelvin. P times V is what? P times V, pressure times volume is what? Pressure times volume is a measure of work. Okay. Pressure is newtons per meter square. Newtons, volume is meter cubed. So P times V is a measure of work. Okay. So if you do work on a, P and you increase the volume, P times delta V, okay, and plus V times delta P will give you a measure of the work done on the, in terms of expansion. Okay. So heat is a form of energy. You must remember that. Okay. So now that is related to temperature using this N time. N is the number of moles, how much you are expanding, right? How much of the matter is involved, right? Is measured in moles, right? Each mole has how many molecules? 6.023 into 10 to the power of 23. Avogadro's number, right? That many molecules. One mole has that many molecules. So now here we are deal with things only in moles. Okay. What is a mole? A mole is a set of molecules, a certain number of molecules. Okay. What is R? R is 8.31 into joules per mole per Kelvin. Okay. And T is measured in Kelvin. All right. So thermal expansion. Most objects expand when heated. Right. Now we already discussed the anomalous case. Anomalous means unusual case. Right. Typically, you put a balloon in water, right? Or, you put metallic lids on glass jars can be opened by placing them in hot water. I don't know if you have done that, right? little bit, they will heat it up, grandma, right? We'll do that. Most objects expand when heated, right? Now, thermal expansion is leads to an increase in size when there is an increase in temperature, right? Metallic lids on glass jars, why does that happen? Because they expand differentially, right? Glass expands less, metal will expand more, okay? So because of that, the that is what leads to thermal expansion, okay? Thermal expansion is an increase in size when there is an increase in temperature. Length increases, right? If there is a length increase, it is called linear expansion. If there is a volume increase, it is called a volumetric expansion. If there is an area increase, it is called area expansion, okay? The three are a little bit different, okay? They are proportionate, but we will discuss that next, okay? So what is this, how proportionate is length, volume, and area in terms of expansion, right? So typically, right, PV equals NRT means that when you heat something, its temperature increases, the volume is going to increase. Okay, now this is for a gas. Remember, PV equals NRT is for a gas. You don't be very, very careful there. Okay, now for a solid, right, although there is a similar rule, basically solids, they don't expand like gases. PV equals NRT, no. Okay. A gas will occupy whatever space you give it. Okay, you just leave it open, it will occupy that space and, it will have a corresponding pressure, right? Solids are not like that, okay? Now, solids have a different kind of expansion. They don't have PV equals NRT. What they have is, they have a coefficient of volume expansion, okay? They have a coefficient of linear expansion, coefficient of volume expansion. Typically, the coefficient of volume expansion, right? So now is basically dV by dt is proportional to, the proportionality of dV by dt, right, is based on the volume, volume expansion, right, is equal to alpha times V. Okay. 1 by V dV by dt, right, equals alpha. Okay. So now, this alpha is, you take this one. Delta L by L equals alpha L times delta T. Okay. Now, area and volume are related. Okay. Now, in the first class, basically when you do 1 plus x to the power to the squared, right, you write it as 1 plus 2x plus x squared, right? What is 1 plus x the whole square? 1 plus 2x plus x squared, right? A plus b the whole square, a squared plus 2ab plus b squared, right? Now, let's say you have x plus delta x the whole square, or l plus delta l the whole square. That is L square plus 2L delta L plus delta L square. Okay. Now, if you say, remember when we say coefficient of expansion, right? Coefficient of expansion does not include the third term, that is the delta L square term. So, they just assume it is a first order expansion. So, L plus delta L. Okay, now when you look at area, right, see what is coefficient, it is a linear expansion. Okay, so if the temperature goes up by a certain degree, delta L by L will equal alpha times delta T. So for each, they assume that it is a linear expansion, goes with a straight line. Okay, however, what happens to area? Area increases at 2 times alpha L, Okay, so if I increase some, if something is one feet and it the length increases by 0.1, right, the area of that, let's say it was a square, the area will increase by, what is 1.1 the whole square? 1.21. Okay, so there is this square and that square, the final square they often ignore. Okay, so they say it increases by the 10% increase in the length leads to a 20% increase in area. Okay, now what happens in the case of volume, right? It will lead to a 30% increase in volume. Okay, so 1.1 times 1.1 times 1.1 is roughly 1.33 or something like that. Okay, so we say it is 1.3. Okay, how much did the volume increase? 30%. That's what they will tell you, roughly speaking. Okay, now, therefore, the coefficient of volume expansion is roughly 3 times the coefficient of linear expansion. Coefficient of area expansion is roughly 2 times the coefficient of linear expansion. Okay, so alpha v equals delta v by v times 1 over delta t. Okay, so so these are the 3 formulas. Okay, delta v by v equals 3 times alpha l delta t. So if they gave you the coefficient of linear expansion, you say that the coefficient of volume expansion is roughly 3 times. But if they give you the coefficient of volume expansion, that is a more accurate measure. Okay, so linear expansion, volume expansion, etc., are related. Okay, now in the case of water, we already discussed anomalous expansion of water. Water has its lowest it has its highest density. Water is most dense at around 4 degrees centigrade. Okay? After that, it starts to expand again. Even after it becomes ice, it keeps on expanding. Okay, as a result, ice floats in water. We already discussed that. Now, if you keep heating water, it will keep expanding up from 5 degrees centigrade onwards. Okay, and it'll keep going in a parabolic way. Keep slowly. Okay, so look at the numbers. 1.000. If you say that happens at this point, right? This happens at 4 degrees. From 4 degrees onwards, it expands. But look at the level of expansion, right? Very, very minimal. Okay, you've gone 100 up to 100 degrees, and that's all there is, right? And it goes to 1.043. Okay, so the density changes, but by small amounts. Okay, but again, the fact that after becoming a solid, it then expands rather than contracts, is called the anomalous expansion of water. Okay, now when we talk of gases, we talk of the ideal gas equation. We already discussed this. PV equals nRT. At constant pressure, an increase in volume leads to an increase in temperature, right? Because now we are discussing volume expansion for gases. So keep the pressure constant, heat the gas. We already discussed Charles' law. The volume will expand. Okay, constant pressure, heat the gas, its volume will expand. Okay, now delta V by V equals delta T by T. Delta V by delta T equals V by T. Okay, so that constant is, you can calculate it from PV equals nRT. You start with PV equals nRT and then you can evaluate it. Okay, so dV by dt is this one. Okay, proportional to V, right? So now the coefficient of volume expansion, coefficient linear expansion, and thermal stress. Okay, now let's say something is packed, okay, in a box. Okay, now let's say it heats up. Okay, what happens is whatever is sitting inside is pushing, okay, and whatever is it is boxed in, that is also pushing, okay. So this is pushing this, that is pushing that, because they are, because of heat, they are expanding, okay. If there is a differential between the box and what is inside, then what happens is there is stress. We just discussed stress last class, right? So there is stress that is pushing this way, right, and this way, okay. Now in buildings, right, that's when we discussed truss. The word truss is a rod in a structure, okay. Now in buildings, thermal stress develops, right? How does thermal stress develop in buildings? The sun is continuously radiating energy, heat energy is absorbed by the building, therefore the rods there, they expand, shrink, etc. Then there is stress developing as a result of heat, okay. So now we have, as a result, right, we have what is called the stress per unit area, force per unit area, right, which then leads to force per unit area is the stress, right, which then stress over strain, delta L by L is the strain, right, stress by strain is equals the Young's modulus, right. So if you want to look at the kind of delta F you have, you multiply, you use stress over strain equals Young's modulus, and you calculate the corresponding thermal stress, okay. Now pendulum, now let's look at this one, okay. This is an example for what happens when you heat something up, right, and we discussed when you have these problems about something getting heated up, the first question you have to ask is, is it a volume coefficient of volume expansion or coefficient of linear expansion? Okay. Now, in the case of a pendulum, the time period is 2 pi times root of L over G, right? 2 pi times root of L over G. The period is proportional to the square root of the length. And of course, G is constant, right? Now, what can be said? Okay. So now, when T goes up, how will, or when L goes up, how will T change, right? What happens is, I don't know, I have seen this. Okay. We used to have a clock in my house, very old clock, for longest time it was there, and that clock would keep time, and every now and then someone would go and adjust the pendulum, Of course they would key it, right? They'll put a key and kar, they'll give a key, but sometimes they'll go and adjust the length of the pendulum. Particularly in the peak heat of the Chennai summer, because the length has expanded, right? The clock is not keeping correct time, right? So now it gains 15 seconds per day if cooled to 0 degrees. Okay. So when you cool it, what happens? L decreases. When L decreases, what happens? Right? Faster. Right? The period declines. Right? L decreases. Period declines, right? And when the period declines, what happens? It seems to have gone more ticks, okay? So that's what happens when the period declines, okay? It seems to have to go more ticks in the same real time, okay? The clock goes more ticks in the same real time. And as a result, it gains time, okay? So now the amount of time that it gains at 20 degrees, T20 is the period at 20, it is equal to T naught, right? Times 1 plus 0.5 alpha theta. Why is that? That is because there is a square root. Okay. Why is there a 0.5? The length goes up by L equals L naught times 1 plus alpha theta. That is a linear expansion. It's a linear equation, right? Now, but the period, because there is the square root, will go up at 0.5. 1 plus x to the power of n is approximately 1 plus nx. Okay. So now, when, and so that's what they are using. They are saying that L equals L naught times 1 plus alpha, alpha times theta. When you do L to the power of half, it is L naught times 1 plus 0.5 alpha theta. Okay. So that's how, because you do have the square root introduces a 1 plus x to the power of n as 1 plus nx, right? The second order terms are, drop, right? And so as a result, you have this equation, you then calculate it, and then you find that the approximate coefficient of linear expansion using the 15-second measure, right, with 15-second increase, using that, you can say the coefficient of linear expansion for copper is 1.7 into 10 to the power of minus 5. All right. So now, let's come back to the problem that we are discussing here, which deals with this idea of what is called the specific heat capacity. So when something absorbs heat, right, or gives away heat, there is a change in temperature and there is a corresponding increase in temperature. Okay? And of course, this is proportional to mass. Okay? So now the specific heat of a body is dq by dt or delta q by delta t. The amount of heat you supply, the amount of temperature that goes up. Of course, S is for a particular body, right? The heat capacity of a body is S. The specific heat is the heat per unit mass. Okay. Therefore, you can say that ms delta theta or ms theta, or where if theta is the change in the temperature, ms theta equals q. So the heat you supply equals m times s times theta. Okay. Now, molar specific heat capacity is the specific heat capacity per mole. Instead of using per unit mass means per kg, you can define it in per kg or you can define it in per mole for a particular substance. Okay. Different substances have different specific heat, but each substance will have the same, mass, right? So they also define the molar specific heat capacity, Then they introduce this molar specific heat capacity at a particular pressure, at a particular volume. Okay. So that it is specific, you want to compare apples and apples, so to speak, right? But in this case, we are discussing, when we discuss constant temperature and pressure, constant pressure and volume, we are discussing what, right? Because now we are changing the temperature, right? So we keep the pressure and the volume constant, right? So when we keep the pressure and the volume constant, right, because of the ideal gas equation, PV equals NRT, P, V, and T are related, right? So if you want to change one thing and measure that one thing, you keep the other two constant, right? So the molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure and constant volume, right? So that you can compare apples to apples, okay? So water has the highest specific heat capacity and heats and cools slower than other substances. Special property of water, okay? It heats and cools slower than other substances, okay? Now, what is calorimetry? A contraction of system in which heat measurement can be done. Okay. So now you isolate everything. There's a wooden jacket inside which, okay, insulating material like wool is kept. Okay. So see, I introduce some heat. I want to measure it accurately. How do I do that? I isolate the surrounding because air, let's say tomorrow, the ambient temperature goes up. That will provide heat and, right? So now you need a thermal insulator. a wooden jacket with wool inside, right? That is a thermal insulator. So inside that, you know, then with just one thermometer, which you can measure, right? Put one thermometer and then from that they measure. Thermometer is a different special kind of thermometer where you can measure even, you know, you don't have to put it and pull it out, etc. You could, right? But typically you just get a reading, okay? So when a hot body is in contact with a cold body in an isolated container, the heat loss by the hot body is gained by the cold body, okay? So a gold sphere, okay, now here's an example, okay? So remember here all we are doing is what is the heat loss is ms theta, right? Where m is the mass, s is the specific heat capacity, and theta is the change in temperature, right? Gold sphere of 0.1 kg is placed for sufficient time in a vessel containing boiling water, so that is at 100 degrees centigrade, is then immediately transferred to a 0.2 kg calorimeter containing 0.25 kg of water at 20 degrees. Temperature of water rises and attains a steady state at 25 degrees. Calculate the specific heat capacity of gold, right? Because it is discussing gold, it's not aluminium, right? So change in temperature of gold is ms theta, right? Theta is 100 degrees to 25 degrees, okay? Now the heat lost by the gold is 0.1, right, mass of the gold times the specific heat of gold times the change in temperature, which is 75 degrees, ms theta, right? For gold is the change in temperature of the gold is 75 degrees. So m 0.1 times s times 75. The heat gained by the calorimeter is the weight of the calorimeter 0.2 times the s of copper, right? And it also contains some water, so it is, so you also have that one. So plus times 5 degrees, because it went from 20 degrees to 25 degrees, plus 0.25 times specific heat of water times 5. So heat lost equals heat gained. This is the formula that will come repeatedly when you deal with heat. Heat lost equals heat gained. Okay? Now there's another thing that happens. Okay? There is a change of state. Okay? Now at each, when something changes from solid to liquid, we say it is melting. Okay? Now the change of state from solid to liquid is melting. The change of state from liquid back to solid is called fusion. Okay? Melting, fusion. Okay? Now regelation happens when there is refreezing due to the removal of pressure. Okay? When you remove the pressure, things freeze again. That is called regelation. Okay, so vaporization is state, change of state from liquid to vapor. Okay, so if you have something is a liquid, it will then become vapor. That is called vaporization. We all know that. Heat water in a vessel, put it on the stove, and then switch on the stove. Eventually, it will become vapor, right? And the point at which you know, there is a point, it stays at the same temperature till all the water will boil. It will start blah 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 blah. All the water will become gas. Okay, so that temperature is the boiling point. And for water, you all know at under normal temperature and pressure, it is 100 degrees centigrade. Okay, the change from solid straight to vapor without passing through the liquid state, it is known as sublimation. Okay, solid straight to vapor without passing through a liquid state, it's called sublimation. Okay, so this change of state, they have what is called a phase diagram. You will see a lot of it in chemistry, but particularly physical chemistry, they deal a lot with this, lot more with this. But here also, it's very, very important in thermodynamics also. Okay, a typical phase diagram. You know, it looks like this. Okay, now the common changes, right, to go from vapor to solid happens at lower temperature. This is a sublimation kind of change. Okay, the most common changes you see is from vapor to liquid. You know, when you boil water, it goes from here to here. Okay, the other change, remember, this is a pressure versus temperature curve. A phase diagram is typically a pressure versus temperature curve. Okay, now the you know, keeping all other things kept equal, right? So now liquid from liquid to vapor also happens. Okay, now as you push up the pressure, you keep going up and up and up, right? It becomes a compressible liquid. Okay, now if you also increase the pressure along with the temperature, it becomes a supercritical fluid. Okay, so you know, there are various types of things. Okay, the sun is a very different kind of things, are kind of very hot, and they exist in a certain thing called the plasma. Okay, in the sun, such a hot body. Okay, okay, so now the red line is called the sublimation curve. We already discussed the term sublimation, straight from solid to gas, right? So the red line here is called the sublimation curve. The sublimation curve meets the blue line, which is called the vaporization curve. And then there is also another curve, which is called the fusion curve, right? Fusion curve is when you know, something goes from solid to liquid, or vice versa. Okay, the separation between solid and liquid is the fusion curve. Okay, now the three lines meet at a certain point called the triple point. Okay, the triple point is the Triveni Sangam of you know, of the phase diagram. Triveni Sangam of the phase diagram is called the triple point. That is the point where the three lines meet: the red line, the sublimation curve, the fusion curve, and the vaporization curve meet at a point called the triple point. Okay, now latent heat is the amount of heat that's added to a body or removed from a body as it changes state. Latent heat of vaporization and latent heat of fusion. Remember that latent heat happens, there is no change in temperature. When something boils, right, at the boiling point, it is absorbing heat and absorbing heat and absorbing heat and changing state. Latent heat happens when the body just changes state at a particular temperature. Okay? So it is directly proportional. Q equals M times L. Latent heat of vaporization, right, is, you know, so that the amount of heat you supply is directly proportional to the mass that you have to provide. Times a constant, that constant is specific to each particular form of matter. Okay, so Q equals ML. Okay, latent heat. So now when you do ms theta, that is when you increase the temperature, right, when you heat a body up. But when it transforms from one form to another, right, you have to supply latent heat m times lf, right, m times l. Okay, so ms the d theta gives you the heat due to change in temperature, due to the change in the state, you get latent heat transfer, right, when it changes state. So M times LF equals will give you the heat when it melts or when it vaporizes, and then you have the corresponding change in the temperature as well, MS delta theta. Okay, so MS delta theta and M times LF based on whether it is change of state or it is just a increase in temperature. Okay, so now heat conduction. Conduction of heat happens when a body has one hot part and another colder, right? So then what happens? Heat is transmitted. As you all know, metals are very good conductors, right? Not just of electricity, but also of heat. Okay, so and so you have the heat is K times A cross section, right? The amount of heat that gets transferred, where K is called the thermal conductivity, K times A times delta T by L, okay, by the length, right? So K times A times delta T by L will give you the heat, okay? So heat conductivity measures how quickly a temperature difference. Remember, the hotter, the cooler, the greater the temperature transfer, the heat transfer. Okay, if they are almost at the same temperature, the heat transfer is lesser and slower. Okay, so remember that. Okay, so an iron chain and a gold pendant are melted together. The iron chain is at 400 Kelvin. The pendant, iron chain, gold pendant, right? The pendant is at 300 degrees Kelvin. What is the temperature at the junction of the pendant and the chain, right? H1 equals K1A1 times Ti minus Tc. H2 equals K2A2 times Tg minus Tc by L2, right? So he's given the lengths, and therefore we solve H1 equals H2, right? So we solve for Tc, the common temperature. One is at 400, the other is at 300. They reach a equilibrium point, K1, A1, K2, A2. Based on that, the H1 equals H2. All right. So remember, K1, A1, T1, Ti minus Tc by L. Okay. So now, convection. Convection happens when there's actual movement of liquids and gases. We do look at conduction. There is no movement. It happens in, through in solids typically, right? Metals particularly, right? Happens when there is convection. Happens when, because things are swirling, right? If you see water, it starts swirling when you keep heating it up, right? Liquids, when they are heated, expand and rise up, and there is a current flow that is created because of that. So they move around, and because of that, there is a transfer of energy. That transfer of energy is called convection. Now, we all know that in the atmosphere also, warm vapor is lighter and therefore rises, and that creates a air current, and because of that you have winds, etc. I used to live in Chennai. In the afternoons there will be a cool breeze coming from the seaside into the city, most people found that a very welcome moment. At lower altitudes, air currents flow inwards to land during the day and outwards during the night. Okay, so either way, the land is cooled by the water, by the side from the water, right? Lower altitudes, air currents flow inwards to the land during the day and outwards during the night, right? So the Earth's rotation modifies the convection current. Okay, air descends at 30 degrees north and returns to the equator. This is called a trade wind. What is a trade wind? It happens when air descends at 30 degrees and returns to the equator. 30 degrees descends and then to the equator. It happens because of the rotation of the Earth. Radiation. What is radiation? Radiation, you all know, sun, right? Infrared light, which is causes heating, right? When infrared light or other electromagnetic waves are transmit across the distance with no medium, it is radiation, right? The sun sends far away. There is no nothing in between. It sends infrared light, that is radiation. All temperatures, all bodies with temperature radiate energy. Even you and I, we radiate. We don't see it because that's the nature of infrared. It is invisible, right? Infrared is invisible. Ultraviolet is invisible. Ultraviolet is not heat, right? Infrared is heat. Okay. Red hot iron or a lamp exhibits thermal radiation. All right. So then finally, black body radiation. This was, it follows what is called Stefan's law, Stefan Boltzmann law. Like the heat is proportional to the fourth power of the temperature, right? A times A is the area and T is the absolute temperature. A E sigma times T to the power of 4. Okay, so A E sigma times T to the power of 4. okay, where S is the surrounding temperature and S, right? So now the amount of heat that is transmitted is T to the power of 4 minus TS to the power of 4, okay? So the proportional to the difference, okay? Then there is also one Wien's displacement law, lambda m times t is a constant. Wien's displacement law, lambda m times t is a constant. Lower wavelengths, right, you have higher temperature, right? Lambda is inversely proportional to t because lmt is a constant. Wien's law. Okay. So finally, there is greenhouse effect. Greenhouse effect happens when the earth, as all of you know, absorbs energy from the sun, which radiates tremendous amount of heat and light. Now, greenhouse effect happens because this heat that is being absorbed is not radiated back. Okay. Infrared heat is absorbed by greenhouse gas in the atmosphere and it stays put because the amount of CO2 is increasing and CO2 absorbs and keeps the heat. It is holds on to the heat while, in the case of the other gas, they just radiate it back. It's the surface of the earth. This heat is then reflected back. Okay? But in the case of CO2, it absorbs some amount of heat and then it holds on to it. And then this heat sits there and then it goes to other places. According to certain scientists, it is believed that the average temperature has increased from 0.3 degrees centigrade to 0.6 degrees centigrade due to an increase in the parts per million of CO2. Okay? The number of parts per million was 290 before humans started using fossil fuels. It is now about 420 parts per million. The expectation of these scientists is that the ice caps will melt and the sea levels will rise due to greenhouse effect. Okay? So that's as much as we want to say about the greenhouse effect. Okay? Now, we come to the most important other thing which leads to a lot of questions often in all these exams, which is called Newton's law of cooling. The rate of loss of heat is directly proportional to the temperature difference between the body and the surroundings. Okay. Rate of loss of heat is dq by dt equals minus k times T minus Ts, where Ts is the temperature of the surroundings, T is the temperature of the particular body. So how quickly will it radiate heat is the rate of loss of heat dq by dt equals minus k times T times T minus Ts, right? So now dq is ms d theta for, let's say a solid, right? So then you write ms d theta equals negative k times T minus Ts. Then you do a integration. Dt over T minus Ts, when you integrate, you end up with ln T, right? And ln T equals k dt, kt plus c. Ms ln T minus Ts equals kt plus C, where what is T? T is time, right? Little t. Big T is temperature. Ms ln T minus Ts, right? And remember that T is continuously changing as time goes on, right? But remember that the lower the temperature difference, the slower it is going to change, okay? So continuously the temperature is changing, it's becoming cooler and cooler and cooler, and it's transmitting lesser and lesser and lesser heat. Okay, that is Newton's law. But remember the law and remember how to do the math. dq by dt equals negative k times T minus Ts. You integrate and then you write dq as ms dt, right? And then it is continuously happening. So you have ms dt by dt equals negative k T minus Ts. Dt by T minus Ts integrated as it becomes ln T minus Ts, right? So, and then equals k T plus C. Okay. So that is the solution to the differential equation. is now when you lawn tea is what, right? You e to the power of kt, negative kt equals e to the power of negative kt equals t minus ts, right? T and ts is t environment. So t of t equals t environment plus t naught minus t environment times e to the power of minus rt. So you have a exponential curve for the temperature of a body as it loses temperature.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select Biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IITPAL. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon that is Gyan Chat. Gyan Chat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon, and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number, of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top, and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box, asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app. where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello, my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In 2018 or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions. And I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT book. That means biology, you have to by heart the NCERT book. Not simply by heart, understanding the concept and by heart. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that is given here in the NCERT, in the Animal Kingdom. Under basis of classification, what we are looking, what characters, what points we are looking to classify the animals, that is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are lot of difference in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. In relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or respiratory.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.